In this deep dive, I'm going to show you how to use the output from one block as the input parameter for another block in your automation. We call this field mapping, and it's the way you want to share information between blocks so your automations run smooth and are easy to read. Grab your popcorn and dig in because you don't want to miss this movie. Blocks require inputs to do their job. For connector blocks, the inputs are the parameters that are sent to the command, also known as an API request, of the connected application. Here's a do reload block on the canvas, and it has an input parameter in the block configurator for the unique ID of a QlikSense application. When the block runs, the input information is sent to the endpoint. There are three ways to provide input to an input parameter: using the lookup command in the input, which returns a pick list to choose a value, manually entering the value of the input parameter, or selecting data from the output of a block that is run previously in the automation sequence. Let's check out each option. The do lookup returns a list of possible values to set as the input parameter. A manual input is just like it sounds. You copy and paste the value you want to use manually into the input parameter field. Using the output from a previous block as the input for a parameter in a following block is called field mapping. Field mapping enables you to select data elements from any previous block and reuse them. Now it's time to dive a little deeper and see how it works. The key to understanding field mapping inputs is to learn about the output from previous blocks. Let's do this first. Most blocks in Qlik application automation produce some kind of output, from strings and numbers to single JSON objects or a list of any of these types. The selected block's output is viewable by clicking on the history tab in the configurator. For connector blocks, the output of a block is the response of the API that was called, and usually this is JSON structured data. Note that in some cases, the output is only part of the full API response, because metadata was stripped or because data was reformatted into JSON. So when you add a block to the canvas, there's often an example output in the history tab that you can use as a placeholder for subsequent blocks in the automation. After configuring the block, you can execute a test run of the automation to retrieve a few records to make sure the response looks like what you expect. Executing a test run, click on the test run option that appears to the left of the block you mouse over. And to retrieve the complete output for a block, save the automation and press the run button. Performing a run redirects the browser to the output screen. And when the automation finishes, clicking on the editor tab, then the block, and then the history tab reveals the full results. A really cool feature in the history tab is arrows here at the top of the response. They allow you to review all of the complete runs this block has performed in this automation. It's very handy when you're troubleshooting data or changes in response payloads. Once you have some output you can reference in another block, you're ready to use field mapping in your automation. Adding a field mapping begins by clicking inside an input field and selecting another block from the automation in the drop-down menu. Once you've selected a block, the output of that block is shown, and you can click on different elements of the output to populate the input. You know you're using output from a previous block by the green pill-shaped representation appearing in the input field. You can provide an input with the entire output payload by clicking on the title of the unfurled output. This is useful when the input requires an object or a list of objects. Sometimes input fields require specific attributes from an output to do a job. For example, the condition block compares a single value from an output. To select a single attribute from an output response, click on the attribute name and the green pill for that attribute appears in the input field. Another cool feature is when you use field mappings, there's no restriction to the number of field mappings you can use in strings. In fact, you can mingle text with field mappings. Here's how you do it. Using an output block as an example, I'm entering some text, then selecting two field mappings where I want the values they represent to appear. The output block prints the sentence, reloaded complete with status and time, because the automation converts the field mappings to text. The green pill effect showing that a field mapping is in use helps you identify where data is coming from. but sometimes you need to look under the hood to review a field mapping reference. Flipping the View Formula switch toggles the green pill effect on and off. In raw mode, field mappings use a syntax that refers back to their source. The root of every field mapping reference is a dollar sign, and then a JSON object notation is used to traverse the path to the referenced attribute. You can edit the field mapping in raw mode, and if it's valid, the referred attribute becomes the highlighted portion in the JSON object structure. Now let's take a look at using field mappings in loops. In this example, I've added a list apps block onto the canvas, which returns a list of ClickSense applications in my QlikCloud tenant. When I add a block inside the loop, the input of the block auto-populates with a reference to a single item in the looping list. Each time the loop iterates, the item is set to the current indexed item in the loop. And you can see the output block I added refers to a list of items of the list apps loop. And if I test run here, I receive output representing a single item. And if I want to retrieve the output of all the items, I can run the automation. Let's say I just want to output the names of the apps in this list. I can drill into the item output and select the name attribute. When I run the automation again, I get a list of all the app names and nothing more. And you can always tell you're working with a list item when you see the word item in the field mapping reference. Now let's look at adding a field mapping from a value in a list when the block using the mapping is set outside the loop. Unlike retrieving each item when the loop iterates, there are more options for how you can work with the list, but it is more complex. When I reference the list output outside the loop instead of a list item reference, the automation wants me to specify a specific value. And when I click a value, a pop-up asks for additional information to process the list correctly. There are three options to choose from. Get the value based on the first item in the list, get all the items in the list, or get an item based on an evaluation on a different item attribute. The first two options are straightforward. The last option, based on evaluation, is a bit more advanced. So let's go through that. When you select the third option, it prompts you to select a value based on a condition. In this example, it's prompting for a name of an app, but it could easily be a different attribute in the list item. Now, what that does is set up the field mapping to return the name of the app that I picked, which isn't really useful. What I want is the content of the entire object based on that name. So what I can do is toggle formula mode and remove this last dot name from the field mapping. Running the automation again returns the entire object. As I wrap up this deep dive, here are a couple of tips to remember when you're working with loops, lists, and field mappings. When you're working with lists and accessing fields from inside or outside a loop, remember this rule of thumb. The word item will always appear in the field mapping reference when you apply a field mapping inside a loop for that looped list. Outside a loop, the list item you access to map data will not have the word item in the field mapping reference because it's not referencing the list item from inside the loop. And another tip, always be aware of the expected input type of a block when you add a field mapping. Some inputs require you to supply a list versus a single list item or a string. For example, list blocks like the filter list expect you to supply a list. When that doesn't happen, the block may not produce an error, but it won't produce the output you're looking for either. I'll have a lot more to say about that when we work with lists in another video soon. And that's the deep dive on field mapping. If you have a field mapping tip you want to share or a question about making your automation sing, join our community at community.qlik.com. We have an application automation forum there that's chock full of how-to guides, Q&A, and advice to help make your QlikApplication automation experience fun and efficient. We'll see you there soon.